إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. We're going to go over the Aqidah of Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah. Yesterday in Slough we went over the Aqidah of Imam Malik rahimahullah, his Aqidah and his Manhaj, famous statements from Imam Malik rahimahullah. And that was part one, and part two will probably be in Slough tomorrow after Isha inshaAllah. And prior to that we did the Aqidah of Sufyan ibn Sa'id al-Thawri rahimahullah, who died 161 Hijriyah. And that was in two parts. And prior to that, alhamdulillah, in Slough we went over the Aqidah of the two great Imams, Abu Hatim al-Razi and Abu Zur'a al-Razi. الإمامين الرازيين، عقيدة الإمامين الرازيين، in the famous عقيدة called أصل السنة. And also مالك الصغير عقيدة، his name is ابن أبي زيد المالكي القرواني، ابن أبي زيد القرواني، in his مقدمة القروانية. We did that, we went over that as well. Why? Because linking the people with أهل العلم. Linking the people with the عقيدة of the سلف، عقيدة السلف. The Aqidah of the pious predecessors, Salaf al-Salih, showing what the Aqidah, the belief was then, because Aqidah is heavy. Aqidah is heavy on the scales on Yawm al-Qiyamah. And the proof is, as Shaykh Rabih Abudullah said, is the Hadith al-Bitaqa. The Hadith of al-Bitaqa. The man will have 99 scrolls of bad deeds, he will come on Yawm al-Qiyamah. With one, if you look at one of the scrolls, it's described as having, as being full of sins, yani as far as the eyes can see. One of the scrolls. How about 99 scrolls of bad deeds? And that will be put on one side of the scales. On the other side of the scales will be put, a card will be brought out for him, written on it, La ilaha illallah. Yani the person's belief in Tawheed, the person's ikhlas, the person's kalimat al-Tawheed, his belief in Tawheed, his aqeedah. And that will outweigh all of the 99 scrolls of bad deeds. And upon that, Shaykh Rabih Abudullah said, this shows you that Aqidah is the heaviest on the scales on Yawm al-Qiyamah. And of course, there is another hadith which mentions that there isn't anything heavier than the akhlaq on the scales. But that refers to other than Aqidah. As for Aqidah, then that is the heaviest. So from the mu'amalat, from the interactions between people, yes, akhlaq is heavy on the scales. But between you and Allah is your Aqidah, is your belief. And Shaykh Rabih Abudullah mentioned that in his explanation of Usul al-Sunnah. Now we go over the Aqidah of Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah and his manhaj and his methodology. Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah, he was born in 150 Hijriyah. And he died 204 Hijriyah, the same year that Imam Muslim was born. 204 Hijriyah. His name is Muhammad ibn Idris, ibn al-Abbas, ibn Uthman, ibn Shafi'i, ibn Sa'ib, al-Qurashi, al-Matlabi. And his kunya is Abu Abdullah. He's a Shafi'i. Great scholars have spoken about him. From them, Abu Dawood al-Sijistani, the Sahib al-Sunan, who said, "Ma ra'aytu Ahmada yamilu ila ahadin a maylahu mithl al-Shafi'i." I didn't see anyone whom Imam Ahmad rahimahullah would sway towards other than al-Shafi'i, yani more than al-Shafi'i. Showing you the love that Imam Ahmad rahimullah used to have for Imam al-Shafi'i. Of course, he's his teacher. And Imam al-Shafi'i rahimullah studied, also benefited from Imam Malik rahimullah. So they benefited from their teachers. And Qutaybah ibn Sa'id, he said, al-Shafi'i imam. And likewise, Ibn Wahab said, al-Shafi'i min a'immatil ulama. And likewise, Ibn Rahawiyyah, from the scholars of hadith, he said, the Shafi'i Imam. So Imam al-Shafi'i was known in his time to be from the great scholars. And these biographies you can find in the Jarh al-Ta'dil, and likewise Manaqib al-Shafi'i of Ibn Abi Hatim, and al-Hilya, and also Sir Alam al-Nubula of al-Dhahabi. You can find the biographies there of Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah. And due to time, we want to go straight into the Aqeedah, as we have promised. And also so we can see the belief of Ahlul Sunnah, what it used to be then. And we link ourselves with that which the people were upon. For what was good for them is good for us. As Imam Malik rahimahullah himself said, لا يصلح آخر هذه الأمة إلا ما أصلح أولها. Nothing will rectify the latter part of this ummah except that which rectified the first part. What was it that rectified the first part? Belief. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَأَنْتُمُ الْعَلَوْنَ إِن كُنْتُمْ مُؤْمِنِينَ. You will be uppermost if you are true believers. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how many times he mentioned about Iman being the fundamental and the foundation. وَالْعَصْرِ إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. First and foremost, Aqeedah. First and foremost, Iman. And Jundub ibn Abdullah radiallahu anhuma, he said, first we learnt Iman, then we learnt Quran, meaning Ahkam, rules and regulations. And that increased us in Iman. But what did he say first? We learnt Iman. The Prophet sent Mu'adh radiallahu anhu to Yemen to teach what? First and foremost, Iman. إِنَّكَ ذَاهِبٌ إِلَهِ الْكِتَابِ فَلِيكُنْ أَوَّلَ مَا تَدْعُوهُمْ إِلَيْهِ شَهَادَةُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ Aqeedah. To teach them Tawheed, Iman in Allah. And that's in Bukhari. Wording is in Bukhari and Muslim. Very similar. One word he mentions, أَن يُوَحِّدُ اللَّهِ. Where does Tawheed come from? From the narration of Rasulullah ﷺ. People say it's a new thing you bring. That's not new. Tawheed is mentioned by Rasulullah ﷺ. أَن يُوَحِّدُ اللَّهِ. That they single Allah out in worship. What does it mean? In the other hadith, شَهَادَةُ أَن لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. So he already explained what Tawheed is. And that is to maintain Allah's oneness in His worship, and to maintain Allah's oneness in knowing His beautiful names and attributes. And before that, maintain Allah's oneness in knowing and affirming His Lordship. That He is the Creator, He is the Planner, and He is the owner of all of the creation, and the King of all of the Master of all of the creation. So Aqeedah comes first. Ya Du'at al-Islam, oh callers to Islam, Aqeedah comes first. And Salaf never differed in Aqeedah. Salaf al-Salih, the Sahaba radiallahu anhu, never differed in Aqeedah. And that is affirmed by the great scholars, past and present, clarifying that the Aqeedah is one, as Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah clarified in his Majmu', and also other great scholars have clarified. And when you look at the Aqaid, like for example what we have in front of us here, this is a new compilation that was brought out, what this student of knowledge has done is put all of the aqaid in the first 500 years with the copy of the manuscript. Can you see the manuscript for each of the aqaid? So you got about over 30 different aqidah of imams, and he put it all in one volume. See, what you usually you would go to Usul Itiqadah al-Sunnah al-Jama'ah of Lalikai, you pick out the aqidah there of different a'imma like Imam Ahmad and rahimahullah, and other than them you go to another book, another compilation, by Ibn Battah, for example, or you go to another compilation by Imam Barbahari later. It's all separate. But what this student of knowledge has put all of those aqaid in one volume, and he called it Al-Jami' fi Aqaid wa Rasail Ahli Sunnati wal Athar. And he actually put 60 aqidas in here. 60 great imams and what they used to believe in. I said, I made a mistake. 60 is mentioned. حَوَّ سِتِينَ عَقِيدَةٌ مِنْ عَقَائِدَ أَهْلِ السُّنَّةِ. And all of them with the proof of the manuscript where the original is. So anyone who comes, you can show them the عَقِيدَةَ أَهْلِ السُّنَّةِ. We don't need to waste time. You can see what they believed in more than 1,200 years ago. More than 1,300 years ago. 1,400 years ago. You can see where they took from. They took from directly from the Sahaba radiallahu anhum or their students. So Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah, this particular aqidah, you'll find in Manaqib al-Shafi'i and Tabaqat, you'll find his mention. So he says, after يونس ابن عبد الأعلى المصري, he says, قال سمعت محمد بن إدريس الشافعي رحمه الله. There's isnad there, mentioned before the whole isnad. I'll just mention the last two, the last one before الشافعي رحمه الله. يقول وقد سئل عن صفات الله. So this is one portion of his aqidah. There may be different portion, different sections of his aqidah in different books. So he's compiled them here. Like yesterday, we were going over the aqidah of Imam Malik rahimahullah. You won't find it all in one place. And he gathered about 87 points from the aqidah of Imam Malik rahimahullah. Aqidah al-manhaj of Imam Malik rahimahullah. So here we have Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah. He says, number one, لِلَّهِ تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى أَسْمَاءٌ وَصِفَاتٌ جَاءَ بِهَا كِتَابُهُ. Allah has beautiful names and lofty attributes, that which has come in his book. وَأَخْبَرَ بِهَا نَبِيُّهُ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ أُمَّتَهُ. And he has mentioned that to the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. And the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, sorry, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم himself has mentioned it to his ummah, clarified it to his ummah, Allah's beautiful names and attributes. لَا يَسْمَعُ أَحَدٌ مِّنْ خَلْقِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلْ قَامَتْ لَدَيْهِ الْحُجَّةُ أَنَّ الْقُرْآنَ نَزَلَ بِهِ وَصَحِعَ عِنْدَهُ بِقَوْلِ النَّبِي صلى الله عليه وسلم فِيمَا رَوَى عَنْهُ الْعَدْلُ خِلَافَهُ. So they were not going to other than that which has come from the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم and from the message and from the from Allah Azza wa Jalla in his book. So the names and attributes that Allah Azza wa Jalla has mentioned for himself and the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم has mentioned for Allah are in the book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. Allah's beautiful names. وَلِلَّهِ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى فَادْعُوهُ بِهَا. Allah has beautiful names, so call upon Allah by them. وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى. And Allah has the best of descriptions, best of characteristics. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of his beautiful names actually are perfect and they are complete without any deficiency. And if you go to Lum'at I'tiqad of Ibn Qudama al-Hanbali, the great scholar in his time, he has a book called Lum'at I'tiqad. And Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah has a muqaddimah of it. The muqaddimah of it is rules and regulations regarding asma'u sifat. Really nice muqaddimah, where you can look at some of the principles of Ahl al-Sunnah regarding asma'u sifat. And if you want more detail, go to Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah's book called Qawa'id al-Muthla, where he has described in detail those principles of Allah's names and attributes. And Shaykh Ubayd al-Jabri has explained it in one volume. In one volume, explained Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah's book called Qawa'id al-Muthla regarding Allah's names and attributes. But just as a point of benefit, if you go to that muqaddimah, you see the principles, from the principles of Ahl-Sunnah regarding Allah's beautiful names and attributes, is that we affirm that which Allah has affirmed for himself. And we affirm that which the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم has affirmed for Allah. يعني we don't go beyond it. As Umar ibn Abdul Aziz rahimahullah himself said, عَلَى اللَّهِ الْبَيَانِ وَعَلَى الرَّسُولِ الْبَلَاغِ وَعَلَنَا التَّسْلِيمِ. Allah clarifies, the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم delivers the message, that clarity, and upon us is to submit. How could we not submit when Allah said, فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُ فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا قَضَيْتُ وَيُسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. By Allah, they do not really believe, they do not truly believe until they make you, O Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, a judge between their affairs. And then they find in their hearts no hesitance in accepting that judgment, and they submit to it wholeheartedly. So whatever Allah has mentioned in the Quran, we submit to it. Whatever the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم has brought to us, we submit to it in that which he has described Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with. As for the hadith in Sunan Abi Dawood, and there's a narration also in Sahih Muslim. The narration in Sahih Muslim that Allah has 99 names. Allah has 99 names. Whoever memorizes, understands it, and acts according to those names for what they entail, then he will enter paradise. Because hafidhaha doesn't just mean man hafidhaha dal jannah. Doesn't just mean just memorize. How many people memorize parrot fashion and they're not with the right understanding? How many people memorize and they don't have any fahm? The Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, نَضَّرَ اللَّهُ مْرِئًا سَمِعَ مَقَالَتِي فَوَعَاهَا وَأَدَّهَا كَمَا سَمِعَهَا. May Allah brighten the face of a person who hears my saying and he conveys it, he not just memorizes it, he understands it and he conveys it just as he heard it. Not just memorizes. Because if you go to Ibn Athir, who has a book called Gharib al-Hadith, which is like A4 size, of those strange words, which may be difficult for some people. He explained the word fawa'aha. What does it mean? Whoever, what does it mean? He said it means who understands it. May Allah brighten the face of a person who not just memorizes, but he understands my saying. And he conveys it just as he has heard it. That's the one whose face is brightened. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum, their faces are brightened because they carried this message and they understood it and they conveyed it just as they heard it. Not like somebody just parrot fashion. He memorizes maybe 40 hadith, or he memorizes Bukhari, or he memorizes, but when it comes to fahm, la adri. When it comes to fahm, he speaks against Sahaba radiallahu anhum. When it comes to fahm, he has a whole page speaking against Sahaba radiallahu anhum. A gift to the Rafida, a gift to the Shia. And then does a new print, and he doesn't explain that he made a mistake. He just covers it. It's covered. New print, take out that page, nobody knows. Nah, it doesn't work like that. For others, you tell them to make tawbah. What about you? You also must make tawbah. That you also put a whole page about Sahaba's errors. And you put a new print of your Friday prayer book, and then all of a sudden, is yani ma'alesh. La, 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 la. It's not like that. Just like you have a big stick for others, you have a big stick for yourself. So you must make tawbah and take back and not speak about Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Allah says, radiallahu anhum wa radu anhu. Allah is pleased with them and them pleased with him. How you speak about the best of the people? The Messenger said, إِذَا ذُكِرَ أَصْحَابِي فَمْسِكُوا. When my companions are mentioned, then withhold. So we love all of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum and we take from where they have taken, and that is from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they didn't ask about asma us sifat to the messenger of Allah. So I said, يسألونك عن الخمر, يسألونك عن الأهلة, يسألونك عن الحيض. Sheikh Ali Nasir al-Faqih mentioned this beautiful benefit. They ask you concerning alcohol. They ask you concerning the moon, the new moon. They ask you concerning women's menses. They ask these questions to the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But nowhere do we find يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْأَسْمَاءُ الصِّفَاتِ. Why? Because it was known. It was mafhum. It was known. It was understood. So Sahaba understood the names and attributes of Allah. That's why they didn't ask about them in more detail. Why? It was known. It was known. That's why Imam Malik rahimahullah said الْإِسْتِوَاءُ مَعْلُومُ. Istiwa is known. كَيْف مَجْهُول. How is unknown. وَالْإِيمَانُ بِهِ wajib, and to believe in it is an obligation. وَسُؤَالُ عَنْهُ بِدْعَةٌ, and to question it is an innovation. Ma Malik rahimullah said that. So all of his beautiful names and attributes, they are known. Just like istiwa is known. Allah rising above the arsh in the way which befits his majesty is known. How is unknown. Don't ask how. Don't ask how his attributes are. How is unknown to you and me. Sheikh Ubaid adds, but they are known to Allah. You see, there is a kayfiyya that Allah knows, but we don't know it. So Shaykh Ali Nasir al-Faqih mentioned that beautiful benefit. Sahaba knew the names and attributes of Allah, and they didn't ask about them, because they knew it, they understood it, and they carried it. It wasn't until later we had the Jahmiyyah who denied Allah's names and attributes, came, and then we had the Jahmiyyah, followers of Jahm ibn Safwan. And then we had the Mu'tazila, who affirmed the names, but not the meaning of the names. So be careful. And they denied the attributes. Then we had after them the Asha'ira. When they came, they affirmed the names. But when it came to the attributes, only that which coincided with their aql. And the rest of them, they made ta'wil. They used allegorical meaning. They used ta'wil, not the apparent, real, known meaning. They used allegorical ta'wil, awwal sifat. Imam Shafi'i rahimullah, he said, so therefore we take that which has come from the book of Allah and the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam regarding Allah's names and attributes. Number two, فَإِنَّهُ فَإِنْ خَالَفَ ذَلِكَ بَعْدَ ثُبُوتِ الْحُجَّةِ عَلَيْهِ فَهُوَ كَافِرٌ بِاللَّهِ. So whoever opposes this, after the names are mentioned to him, he knows the book, in the book of Allah, the names are there, and he opposes, then he has disbelieved in Allah. But look how Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah is saying to you, don't be like Takfiri. Look at what he said, number three. Look how beautiful this number three is. Number three is a reply to the Takfiris who go around calling Muslims kuffar. That person might be ignorant. He might not know. He might be ignorant, and ignorance could be an excuse. So number three, Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, the last part of number two, he says, فَأَمَّا قَبْلَ ثُبُوتِ الْحُجَّ عَلَيْهِ مِنْ جِهَةِ الْخَبَرِ فَمَعْذُورٌ بِالْجَهْلِ. As for before the hujjah is placed upon him, meaning before you actually show him the proof, he says then he's excused with ignorance because he doesn't know. And Allah mentioned in Surah An-Nisa, verse 115, مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَى. After the clarification has been given to them. So first you have to clarify to the person before you go around calling people kuffar. The general ruling, whoever denies Allah's names and attributes is a kafir. That's the general ruling. Ahlul Sunnah, they mentioned two rulings, the general and the specific. The general ruling is not a Muslim. Who does that? Whoever does prostration to a grave, he's a mushrik. But now specific ruling, that person, I know who he is Ahmad ibn whoever, Abdullah. Is he a kafir? First, you establish the proof upon him. They do out of ignorance. And Muhammad Abdul Wahhab, rahimahullah, he mentioned this clearly in his book called Risalatun ila Ahli al-Qasim. And right at the end, he said, many people accuse me of making takfir of Muslims. Many people accuse me of saying Muslims are kuffar. He says, I don't even say a person doing prostration, a person prostrating to a grave, I don't even say he's a kafir until I establish the proof upon him. So now he's speaking about the specific ruling. So if you go to the works of Ibn Abdul Barr, the statements of Ibn Abdul Barr and Ibn Qudama, Ibn Abdul Barr al-Malikin, Ibn Qudama al-Hanbali, and Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, who came afterwards, and Ibn al-Qayyim, and those who came before them, Imam Ahmad in his application, you will find out there is ijma', there is consensus of Ahlul Sunnah, that you don't go around calling Muslims kuffar until you go and establish the proof upon them that what they have done from the actions of kufr, that they have done it willfully, they have done it with knowledge. They have done it with knowledge and they intended that. Those two conditions actually, Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah mentions, al-ilm wal-qasd. Al-ilm wal-qasd. Knowledge, and they had to intend that. And he brings proof. When I went to visit him in Unayza, he mentioned this to me. When I said to him, there are a group of takfiris in England, they are saying such and such. And he mentioned these two points, which I mentioned in his book, Qawaid al-Mutlab, it came after that visit. When I said that, he said to me, two hadith. Number one, the man who said to his family, when I die, burn my body, and the ashes, throw them in the sea, throw them in the land, because I've done so many bad deeds, I don't want Allah to bring me together and punish me. And they did that. And Allah, the messenger asked him, said he will come Yawm al-Qiyamah, and Allah will forgive him, because he knows that he fears Allah. He was ignorant. So ignorance was an excuse for that individual. He was ignorant of the fact that Allah would put him together and call him to account. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgave that individual because of his deep fear of Allah. As for the other narration, which mentions qasd, which mentions the aspect of qasd, of intention, then the man who said to, the man who actually slept under the shade of a tree with his provisions, his riding beast, woke up, riding beast, and his provisions, had gone. He lost his riding beast, he lost his provisions. He slept again under the shade of a tree, he woke up and he saw his riding beast with his provisions. And so much happiness, he said, oh Allah, you are my slave and I am your Lord. He uttered the statement of kufr. Oh Allah, you are my slave and I am your Lord. He didn't intend it. It was a slip of the tongue. أَخْطَأَ مِنْ شِدَّةِ فَرَحِهِ. He made a mistake out of extreme happiness. Oh, he found his riding beast. He found his provisions. Oh Allah, you are my servant and I... So he didn't intend the statement of kufr. So Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah says, two conditions we got before you specifically call any Muslim a kafir. He has to intend and he has to have knowledge. And here Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah likewise mentions it here. فَأَمَّا قَبْلَ ثُبُوتِ الْحُجَّةِ عَلَيْهِ مِنْ جِهَةِ الْخَبْرِ فَمَعْذُورٌ بِالْجَهَلِ. لأن علم ذلك لا يدرك بالعقل. Because the knowledge of knowing the names and attributes is not known by عقل, is not known by one's intellect. ولا بالرواية والذكر, nor by anyone speaking about it or narrating much, or by thoughts. ونحو ذلك إخبار الله عز وجل إيانا أنه, and then he mentioned some of the names and attributes of Allah. For example, he says number three, Allah is سميع, that he hears, that he's all hearing. وأن له يدين, and he has two hands, and in narration two right hands. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, بَلْ يَدَاهُ مَبْسُوطَتَانِ, both his hands are outstretched. When the Jews said his hands are tied, he says, غُلَّتْ أَيْدِيكُمْ, may your hands be tied. بَلْ يَدَاهُ مَبْسُوطَتَانِ, his two hands are outstretched. And he gives to whomsoever he wills. And he gives in plenty. Number four, وَأَنَّ لَهُ يَمِينًا, بِقَوْلِ عَزَّ وَجَلْ, وَالسَّمَاوَاتُ مَطْوِيَّاتٌ بِيَمِينِهِ. So Ghafir, and he, Zumar, 67, and that he has, here he mentioned a right hand, and in the hadith he mentions two right hands, because it's two hands, and he said that the heavens are rolled up in his right hand, the heavens, يوم القيامة. This is وما قدر الله حق قدره, they did not make a just estimate of their Lord. والأرض جميعا قبضته يوم القيامة, and all the earth will be his grasp on the day of judgment. والسماوات مطويات بيمينه, and the heavens will be rolled up in his right hand. سبحانه وتعالى عما يشركون, sublime is Allah from any imperfection. Subhanallah. The best translation I found was from Abu Iyad, Jazallah Khair. We used to say, high is Allah from imperfection, but it's a long one. High is Allah from imperfection. So Abu Iyad, Jazallah Khair, from the best of the translators, he said, a better translation and shorter translation is, sublime is Allah. Allahu Akbar. May Allah reward the brothers in the Maktaba Salafiyya. Years they have been bringing out these aqaid of the Salaf. Who translated Mountains of Knowledge? A book that you can get, Mountains of Knowledge, before many of you came into the Dawah, more than 10 years ago. Who translated that? Abu Iyad, Rahim, Hafidhullah. May Allah return the brothers in well-being, inshallah, from Hajj. May Allah reward them. Time and time again, years after years. Wallahi, we sat with the brother, we see, has knowledge, has benefit, has understanding on these affairs, because he reads, and he studies, and he benefits, he takes from the Ahlul Ilm. He's not isolated, like some people. Even if you are a strong student of knowledge, you can't be isolated from those who are older than you, from the ulama. You isolate yourself, you are going against a big wave. You isolate yourself, you're going to go against a brick wall. And we've seen that from those who they call Allama and all this. In the end, there's no Allama. Yes, he memorized this one and that one. But what happened when you isolate yourself? What did Sheikh Rabbi Hafidhullah say about that individual? He said, you are upon a valley and the Ulama are going another valley. You see? Ulama fi wad wa anta fi wad. And what you have put forward here is you've corrupted this affair of ilm al-hadith regarding what you've done in your writing. Showing you, because Shaykh Rabbi Hafidhullah is the imam. When you read his books, he's the imam. Even when somebody said to him, that same individual said to him, I've got 1,000 students ready to refute you. We saw the likes of their students. They got chewed up. Then one of them tried to criticize Shaykh Rabbi with an affair. What happened to him? Sheikh Rabi rudded him with two refutations. And if you got knowledge and you study properly, you will see who's the man and who's the boy. Or who's the imam and who's the one who is trying to be the imam. So have respect for your elders. Have respect for the ulama. And don't be isolated. You be isolated from these great scholars, you're lost. And you speak ill of Ahl al-Tawheed, the people of Sunnah, you are lost. Khasirt. You're not looking at the big picture. You're looking at a small keyhole. And you think you're going to go a long way. You're going to fail. Because the Prophet said that Allah said, مَنْ عَادَى لِي وَلِيًّا فَقَدْ آذَنْتُهُ بِالْحَرْبِ. Whoever harms a friend of mine, then I'm at war with him. And who are the friends of Allah except the ulama? Those who are amilun. The ulama of Ahlul Sunnah, ulama al-Tawheed. Because they are the ones, as the hadith mentions, they stick to the fara'id, the obligatory acts, and they stick to the nawafil. You see that with them. They strive to worship Allah. نعم. شيخ محمد البنا for example, he used to spend every night doing tahajjud, as his family mentioned to my family, every night. علماء, they are sticking to the faraid and doing the nawafil. You look at his ibadah, every Monday, Thursday he's fasting. Look at his Quran, every Friday he's finishing Quran. Ya Abdullah, ulama. And look who they used to praise and who praised them at that time. He used to be Sheikh Albani, rahimahullah's neighbor. He said, when he was in Medina, he used to be my neighbor. But when in the majlis, I don't speak. In front of Sheikh Albani, I don't speak. Sheikh Muhammad bin Hadi as well, he said, in the majlis, Sheikh Albani, rahimahullah, he is the asad, the lion of the majlis. He is the lion of the majlis. Imam Shafi'i, rahimahullah, continues, he said, number three, Sami'un, Allah is your hearing, we mentioned that. Number four, we mentioned that Allah Azza wa Jal has a right hand. Number five, وَأَنَّ لَهُ وَجْهًا, and he has a face. بِقَوْلِ, we don't know how, but we have to affirm it, because Allah said it. كُلُّ شَيْءٍ هَالِكٌ إِلَّا وَجْهًا, all will be perished except his face. And in the other verse, وَيَبْقَى وَجْهُ رَبِّكَ ذُو الْجَلَالِ وَالْإِكْرَامِ, the face of your Lord will remain. Surah Al-Rahman, verse 27. And also in Surah Kahf, يَرْجُونَ وَجْهَ وَاسْبِرْ نَفْسَكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ بِالْغَدَاتِ وَالْعَشِيِّ يُرِيدُونَ وَجْهَ, and be patient with those who call upon their Lord morning and evening seeking his face. I went through about 15 translations of Quran. They translate all over the place. They tried not to affirm the face. They say seeking his reward, seeking his countenance, seeking his... They try to go away from affirming that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what he has mentioned for himself. We don't know how, but we have to affirm. Number six, وَأَنَّ لَهُ قَدَمًا بِقَوْلِ صَلَى اللَّهِ وَسَلَّمْ حَتَّى يَضَعَ الرَّبُّ عَزَّ وَجَلْ فِيهَا قَدَمَهُ, يعني جهنم. That the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم mentioned that Allah Azza wa Jal will put his foot over Jahannam until it will say, قط قط, enough, enough. And we affirm that. And we affirm. Some of the Sufis, they say that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts his foot in there, khalas, Jahannam becomes Jannah. They add it to the narration that Jahannam becomes Jannah, so there's no Jahannam eternally. The Sufis, they say that. There's no eternal hellfire. Where did they get that from? They got it from their own opinions. We know Jannah, we know Jahannam is forever for the mushrikun. And Allah لا يغفر شرك به ويغفر ما دون ذلك لمن يشاء. Allah will not forgive that you commit shirk with him, and he forgives anything else besides that. So this is affirming, this hadith is in Bukhari and Muslim, hadith of Anas radiallahu anhu, is affirming the foot of Allah. That you place it over Jahannam, once it will, and then it will say, قط قط, enough, enough. And we affirm that. Who said this now? Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah. Why? Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah is up against the Jahmiyyah. Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah is up against the Mu'tazila. He's up against these misguided groups. So he's affirming, laying foundations that we affirm this. This is our da'wah, this is our aqidah. Number seven, وَأَنَّهُ يَضْحَكُ مِنْ عَبْدِهِ مُؤْمِنْ لِقَوْلِ صَلَى اللَّهِ وَسَلَّمِ لِلَّذِي قُتِلَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ إِنَّهُ لَقِيَ اللَّهَ عَزَّ وَجَلْ وَهُوَ يَضْحَكُ إِلَيْهِ. Affirming thee that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala laughs, an attribute befitting his great majesty. That the one who dies a martyr, not those who kill themselves and kill innocent people, they're not martyrs. Those who kill innocent people. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said about the one who killed himself with his dagger. He said, "Huwa fi nar," he's in the hellfire. He's in the hellfire. Sahaba didn't see that he killed himself. They said he's fi jannah. They thought he's in paradise. Prophet said, "Huwa fi nar." So killing yourself with your own hands, there's no proof in the Quran and Sunnah to do that, to say it's allowed. There is no proof in the Quran, in the Sunnah, to show it is allowed to kill yourselves with your own hands. Maafi. Qardawi tried to bring the hadith of the boy, of Ghulam, the one they tried to kill, they couldn't kill him. In the end, he said to them, if you really want to know how to kill me, because they tried to drown him, he couldn't drown, they threw him off a cliff, he didn't die. They tried to kill him. It's a long story. But in the end, He said, no, actually, if you want to know how to kill me, gather everyone. Yeah? And then say, Bismi Rabbil Ghulam. Bismi Rabbil Ghulam. And then you will be able to kill me. And they said that, and they were able to kill him. Then they believed in Allah. So Qardawi using this hadith, say, look, suicide bombing is allowed. He did it. But he didn't kill himself with his own hands, did he? Others killed him with their hands. Bring hadith, as the scholars say, that is allowed to kill yourself with your own hands. And plus, look at the benefit. They all believed. Thereafter, the whole town or village, they all believed. And he was gonna, they were trying to kill him, they're trying to kill him anyway. So why can you use this proof to say you can kill yourself with your own hands? When Allah said, وَلَا تُلْقُوا بِأَيْدِيكُمْ إِلَى التَّهْلُكَةِ, don't cause destruction with your own hands. And Allah Azza wa Jalla said, وَلَا تَقْتُلُ أَنفُسَكُمْ, don't kill yourselves. Clear verses. So those who kill themselves and they kill others, innocent people, got nothing to do with anything, then the fire, the fire. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If they don't make tawbah, then the fire, the fire. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from his attributes, he laughs. And he laughs at the one who died a martyr. Number 8. And that narration actually, حديث حسن, he said للشواهد كثيرة, and mentioning Muslim Imam Ahmed. Number 8, وأنه يهبط كل ليلة إلى السماء الدنيا بخبر الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم بذلك. And Allah Azza wa Jal, he says, he descends to the lowest heavens in the last third part of the night. And there's another Imam called Shariq al-Qadi. They came to him, they said to him, oh Shariq, a group of Mu'tazila, they deny that Allah descends in the last third part of the night. They use their aqal, they use the intellect, like Hizb al-Tahrir, Muhajirun, all these Sharia people, so-called Sharia people. They don't even start with aqidah when it comes to Sharia. Start with aqidah, ya akhi. Start with manhaj. You want to establish the whole Islamic state, you can't even establish your aqidah upon Sharia, upon the Quran Sunnah. Establish the aqidah first. If you want to start, we're going to have Islamic state built upon what? Cooperation with the Rafida, cooperating with this one, that one, with all different beliefs. What kind of Islamic state is that? You'll be the first to be dealt with. Number 8, وَأَنَّهُ يَهْبِطُ. So every night, in the last third part, Allah descends. And this affirms that Allah descends. That's from his attributes. That he yanzilu. And on يَوْمَ الْعَرَفَ يَدْنُ. He comes close to his servants. يَدْنُ. Yes, Allah comes close to his servants. On يَوْمَ الْعَرَفَ. And he boasts to the angels about his servants who have come disheveled, dusty. And he forgives most of the people on that day. And Sheikh Salih Fawzan said, not only in Arafah, but also outside Arafah. Those who are deserving of it. So Allah descends and Allah rises. I went through 15 translations of Quran. All of them, they when they get to Allah, istiwa, they don't know what to translate istiwa. Because they don't take it back to Fahm al-Salaf. They don't take it back to the understanding of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The one who got it exactly right was Taqiyuddin Hilali with Muhsin Khan, rahimahumullah. They got it exactly right. What did they say? About istiwa, Allah rising above the arsh, they say that he rose above. They use two words, rose above. Beautiful. And if you go back to the statements, you got Mujahid, the student of Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, who said, I stopped Ibn Abbas upon every verse. I stopped Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma upon every verse. And who's Ibn Abbas? حبر هذه الأمة ابن عباس. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, اللهم فقهه في الدين وعلمه تأويل. That's ابن عباس رضي الله عنه. رضي الله عنهما, great صحابي, the cousin of رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Mujahid said, and Abu Aliya, who died 110 Hijriya, they both said that استواء means ارتفع وعلى. That he rose and he's above. You see how beautiful that is? He rose and he's above. Not from me. Not from anyone coming late. Mujahid and Abu al-Aliya. From the Salaf time. He rose and he's above. In a manner which befits his majesty. And Allah descends. In a manner which befits his great majesty. These are names and attributes of Allah that we have to affirm. That he's the first and the last and the highest and the nearest. Surah Al-Hadid, هو الأول والآخر والظاهر والباطن. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم explained it. هو الأول ليس قبله شيء. He's the first no one before Allah. He's the last no one after Allah. He's the highest no one above Allah. And he's the nearest no one closer to you than Allah by his knowledge. As Sufyan al-Thawri rahimahullah died 161 Hijriya. When they asked him, "Huwa ma'akum ayna ma kuntum," he's with you wherever you are. He said, by his knowledge, he knows what you're doing. Wallahi, this aqeed of Ahlul Sunnah only increases us in Iman. This aqeed of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, knowing who Allah is, knowing your Lord, knowing the beautiful name Allah, where all other names follow. Allah. Allahu la ilaha illa. Allah. Ibn Abbas radhiyallahu anhu said, it means dul uluhiyya, the one who deserves to be worshipped. So if you know Allah, then you know who you are. Slave of Allah. Abdullah. Inam. Abdullah. Slave of Allah. In need of Allah. Wallahu al-ghani wa antum fuqara. So Allah is the first, the last, the highest, and the nearest. No one above Allah. He's the highest. Shaykh al-Bani, when he was discussing in the time of Hajj, one Azhari from Cairo, from Azhar University, they came and won debate with the Sheikh, and he was debating with Allah about Allah being above the Arsh. So Sheikh al-Bani, this man's using his intellect, so Sheikh al-Bani, when it comes to arguments and debating and discussing, he knows where to come. He knows, he's the Asad of the Majlis. So he said to the man, okay, what is above the first heaven? He said, the second heaven. What's above the third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh? What's above the seventh heaven? Saqf. The roof. What is that? The Arsh of Ar-Rahman. Shaykh al-Bani said, I thought, khalas, we finished with the creation. Huh? Huh? I said, what is above then the Arsh? He says, Kurubiyun. Angels flying. Angels flying. Kurubiyun. What about, where's, huh? Where is Allah? The angels flying. What about Allah? Say what Allah said in the Quran. Ar-Rahman al-Arsh istawa. The most merciful is above. And he rose above the Arsh. Say what Allah said. Who told you Kurubiyun? He said, that's what they taught us in Azhar. That's what he taught in Azhar. But what did the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam teach the slave girl? When the Ash'aris came to debate with Shaykh al-Bani in his own home. And he said to him, Shaykh al-Bani said, I want to discuss the hadith of al-Jariyah. They said, no, we don't want to discuss that hadith. He goes, you've come to me. I didn't come to you. I want to discuss the hadith of Jariyah. And I want to ask you the question, where is Allah? They're going right, left, here, there, everywhere. He said, just say what Allah said. Ar-Rahman al-Arsh istawa. What's the problem? Why are you afraid of this question? Where is Allah? Why are you afraid, Yahi? When the Prophet ﷺ asked it, Ayn Allah? Hadith Sahih Muslim. Hadith of Muawiyah ibn Hakam al-Sulami. Why are you afraid? When the Prophet ﷺ asked it. And the slave girl, you see how knowledge was widespread. Then even the slave girl knew the answer. After she said, you are Rasulullah ﷺ, she knew the answer. And what was the answer? She pointed up. Allah is above. Fi sama. She pointed up, signifying that Allah is above. And she said, Fi sama. And fi here means above. How do we know that? First of all, from her ishara. From her pointing up. Huh? From her pointing up. Fi could mean in. But also could mean above. Allah said in the Quran, Wamshu fil ardi. Doesn't mean go in the land, means go above the land. You don't go inside the land, do you? You go above the land. So it has different meanings. And in this meaning, it means above because of her ishara. She pointed up. And there's long discussion about that, by the way. Long discussion. And if you're not ready in Mustalah Hadith, because they try to come from another angle. And it's quite detailed. They say, oh, there's another wording. In Sunan Abi Dawood, where the same incident, the Prophet ﷺ asked her, Atashhadin, do you bear witness? So, Saqaf, the teacher, this Sufi innovator, Ash'ari, who claims that Shaykh Islam Ibn Taymiyyah is a kafir, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, look how they have gone down to that level, claiming great scholars, a'imma, great scholars who revived the aqeed of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, he claims he's a disbeliever. Hassan Saqqaf, what did he say? He said, hadith is not accepted, because we don't accept the hadith in Sahih Muslim, where is Allah? Because there's another wording we say, which says, atashhadin, do you bear witness? Do you bear witness? And so therefore, that is more likely to have been said because that affirms uluhiyah, worship. Do you bear witness? Yes, I bear witness that none has the right to be worshipped. So he came from that angle. So he said the hadith in Sahih Muslim is muttarib, is rejected, because it goes against another narration which is more sound. Shaykh Albani rahimahullah said to him, first and foremost, slow down. First and foremost, which scholars of hadith said the hadith in Sahih Muslim is muttarib? That's number one. Which scholars before you just came yesterday? Which scholars said this? We have scholars of hadith, mashallah, centuries after centuries they have come. You're the first one now to say this hadith is rejected. Scholars have accepted this throughout the centuries. Secondly, if you look at the narrators in Sahih Muslim, thiqat, they are precise, trustworthy narrators of a higher level than the ones you've mentioned in Sunan Abi Dawud. Number three, before you go around saying hadith muttarib is rejected, first and foremost, we have to see if we can bring them together. Isn't it possible Rasulullah asked both questions? Ain Allah, where is Allah? And at-tashhadin, do you bear witness? Where is the contradiction there? Where is Allah and do you bear witness? What's the problem, Yahi? You have a problem with that? There's no problem. Because, and they said, oh, but the hadith of Ain Allah does not affirm aqidah. Allahu Akbar. You've just now dug your grave and fallen into it. What do you mean doesn't affirm aqidah? Isn't Tawheed al-Asma' al-Sifat aqidah? Tawheed al-Asma' al-Sifat is one of the categories of the three categories of Tawheed. Naam. Allah mentioned it in one verse. Three categories of Tawheed. Rabbu samawati wal ardi wa ma baynahuma. You Lord of the heavens and the earth and that which is between them. Fa'budhu wastabir li'ibadatih. So worship him and be patient upon his worship. Hal ta'lamu lahu samiyya. Do you know any similitude unto Allah? Three categories of Tawheed. From it is Tawheed al-Asma' al-Sifat. And you're saying it doesn't affirm aqidah. Of course it affirms aqidah. Allah being above the arsh is aqidah. And that's why the Prophet asked it. That's why he asked it. Showing you that aqidah comes first. Aqidah is important. Aqidah of Asma' al-Sifat. You know your Lord, ya akhi. You're praying to Allah. Wallahi only increases us in iman. Why? Because Ahlul Sunnah, whenever they talk about Allah's names and attributes, they always say, Laysa kamithlihi shay. There is none comparable unto Allah. Wa huwa sami'un basir. And he's all hearing, all seeing. So we affirm that which Allah has affirmed for himself. And that which the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has affirmed for Allah. Innahu laq. Na'am. So therefore Allah descends in the last part of the night from the hadith which is authentic. Number 9, Imam al-Shafi'i rahim. Anyway, that discussion there with Shaykh al-Ba'i defeated them. They went home. Alas. Number 9, wa annahu laysa bi'a'war. That Allah is not one-eyed. Because the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when he spoke about the Dajjal being a'war, that he is blind in one eye. إِنَّهُ أَعْوَرُ وَإِنَّ رَبَّكُمْ لَيْسَ بِأَعْوَرُ. Allah is not like that. Because this is deficiency. And you don't say that, you don't speak about Allah in that manner. So the Prophet ﷺ mentioned this hadith, and this hadith is in Bukhari and Muslim, in Muslim Imam Ahmad. In Bukhari and Muslim and Muslim Imam Ahmad. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees. Na'am. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described the ark of Noah, he said, تَجْرِي بِأَعْيُنِنَا. That it sails. Under our eyes. تَجْرِي بِأَعْيُنِنَا. نعم. And there are other verses where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala affirms his eyes, his sight. And I ask Sheikh Muhammad bin Hadi, Hafidhahullah, can we translate also, because some translations of Quran, when they come to تَجْرِي بِأَعْيُنِنَا, or when they come to the other verse regarding Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, that is under our eyes. وَاصْطَنَعْتُكَ لِنَفْسِي. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that he has created him and he made him for himself, yani a great worshipper, Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. And one of the verses that he was kept under his eyes, meaning under, and they mentioned in the translation, under our sight. بِنَظَرِنَا. So Ashraf Muhammad bin Hadi, is this ta'wil? He said, no. If they mention binadarina, this is also affirmation of Allah's eyes. Because another sight is from where? It's from the eyes. So therefore, we affirm that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has eyes, and he sees, and he hears, subhanahu wa ta'ala, نعم. And we affirm that for Allah. We don't know how, but we affirm it. Number 10, وَإِنَّ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَرَوْنَ رَبَّهُمْ. The believers, they will see their Lord. عز وجل يوم القيامة, on the day of judgment. بِأَبْصَارِهِمْ, by their eyes. They will see them. The believers, they will see Allah يوم القيامة. كَمَا يَرَوْنَ الْقَمَرْ لَيْلَةَ الْبَدْرِ. Just as they see the moon on the night of Badr. يعني they don't push and shove. They don't crowd. لا تضامون في رؤيته. You don't push and shove. Don't have any difficulties. Not cloudy. Not, it's clear to see the moon on the day, on the night of Badr, full moon. Likewise, the believers, يوم القيامة, will see Allah. So go to Surah Al-Qiyamah. وجوههم يومئذ ناظرة. On that day, faces will be brightened, illuminated. إلى ربها ناظرة. Looking towards their Lord. And in Surah Qaf, وأزلفت الجنة للمتقين غير بعيد هذا ما توعدون لكل أواب حفيظ. الله أكبر. شيخ محمد بن هذا is beautiful explanation of this verse. وأزلفت الجنة للمتقين غير بعيد. Paradise is prepared for the pious ones. It's not far away, يا عبد الله. غير بعيد. It's not far away. يرونها بعيدة ونراه قريبة. ونراها قريب. They see it far away. And Allah says is close. It's close, Ya Abdullah. Just a few days' patience. As Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah himself said, Ya nafsu juzi'ani, Ya nafsu ma hiya ila sabru ayyam. Oh my soul. He's talking to himself. To be patient. Oh my soul, is only a few days' patience. Ya nafsi ma hiya ila sabru ayyam. Ka'anna muddatu adghathu ahlam. Its extent is like a few dreams. Ya nafsu juzi'ani dunya mubadira. Oh my soul, go. Also go through this life quickly. فَإِنَّ الْعِيشَةَ قُدَّمَا. For the real life is ahead of us. The real life is ahead of us. That's the real life. وَالْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَى. It's better and everlasting. It's coming, يا أخي. And you are going to meet your Lord. What? Sooner or later, you're going to meet your Lord. يَا أَيُّهَا الْإِنسَانِ إِنَّكَ كَادِحٌ إِلَى رَبِّكَ كَدْحًا فَمُلَاقِيهِ. Oh mankind, you are going to your Lord and you're going to meet him. Allahu Akbar. And you're going to meet him. وَأَنَّ مَرَدَّنَا إِلَى اللَّهِ فَسَتَذْكُرُونَ مَا أَقُولُ لَكُمْ وَأُفَوِّضُ أَمْرِ إِلَى اللَّهِ. And our return is going to be to Allah. You remember what I said to you. Our return is going to be to Allah. What you're going to see all is going to become apparent. يَوْمَ لَتُبْلَى السَّرَائِرُ فَمَا لَهُ مِنْ قُوَّةٍ وَلَا نَاصِرٍ. All will become apparent. The secrets become apparent. يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. And you will not have anyone to give you victory, to give you aid, nor you have any authority. إني سلطان هلك عني سلطانية خذوه فغلوه ثم الجحيم صلوه ثم في سلسلة ضرعها 70 ذراعا فاسلكوه. Chain him for that disbelieving wretched soul. Chain him because he never used to believe in Allah. إنه كان لا يؤمن بالله العظيم. دينها بعقيدة. كان لا يؤمن بالله العظيم. نعم. ولا يحض على طعام المسكين. فليس له اليوم هاهنا حميم. He has no friends that time. No one to help him. Who's going to help you, أخي, when your mother and your father and your brother and your sister and your son and daughter running away from you? يوم يفر المرء من أخيه وأمه وأبيه وصاحبته وبنيه لكل امرئ منهم يومئذ شأن يغنيه. Everyone's busy with himself. Everyone's scared. يوم القيامة خلاص. This is you and your actions. نعم. That's the reality. لكل امرئ منهم يومئذ شأن يغنيه. وجوههم يومئذ مسفرة ضاحكة. That day faces will be bright and happy, rejoicing. الله أكبر. وجوههم يومئذ عليها قترة. And on that day faces darkened, blackened. Miserable. Sins after sins. أولئك هم الكفرة الفجرة. They are the disbelievers, the wretched ones. صلى الله سلامة. عقيدة. عقيدة comes first. أي والله. And we spend, not like as Hamza Yusuf said, spend 10 minutes learning Aqidah, that's it. That's why you're saying, Ya Madad, Ya Rasulullah. That's why you're upon shirk. That's why you're saying, help me, O Messenger of Allah, on YouTube in a gathering of Mgharba, in a gathering, say, Madad, Ya Rasulullah, Madad, because you only spent 10 minutes studying Aqidah, as you yourself said. Spend a bit more time, Ya Akhi. Spend a bit more time, you won't be doing that shirk. You won't be upon that incorrect Aqidah. Spend a bit more time. More than that, scholars write in volumes after volumes, preserving the aqeedah of Ahlul Sunnah. You say 10 minutes. صلى الله عليه وسلم. Believers will see Allah. أزلفت الجنة للمتقين غير بعيد. هذا ما توعدون لكل أواب حفيظ. Sheikh Muhammad bin Hadi mentioned, look, this is what you were promised. For who? لكل أواب. Who is أواب? The one who is continuously repentant. أواب رجاع. دائما يرجع إلى الله. He makes a mistake, oh Allah forgive me. He makes istighfar 100 times a day. Awwab, continuously coming back to Allah, asking Allah for forgiveness. He's awwab. لكل أواب حفيظ. نعم حفيظ. يحفظ نفسه. يحفظ دينه. يحفظ نفسه عن المحرمات. He guards himself against the haram. نعم. احفظ الله. يحفظك. You guard Allah's duties, Allah will guard you. احفظ الله. تجده تجاهك. You will find him in front of you. Guard Allah's duties. You will find him in front of you. احفظ الله تجده تجاهك. أمامك. Allah will be there for you. Aiding you. إن الله مع الذين اتقوا والذين هم محسنون. Helping them. Because he's with them with the ma'iyya الخاصة. Helping them. Because they are believers. They are minun. They will see Allah يوم القيامة. هذا ما توعدون لكل أواب حفيظ. من خشي الرحمن بالغيب. Whoever fears Allah in the unseen. يعني in secret. He's on his own. Is he going to go and do haram? He's on his own. No one's looking now. Just him and Allah. What is he going to do? Inclined to the, as Qahtani mentioned, his nuniyya. وإذا خلوت بريبة في ظلمة والنفس تدعو إلى الطغيان فاستحي من نظر إله وقل لها إن الذي خلق الظلام يراني. When you're alone and your soul is inclined to transgression. So say to your soul, fear Allah. Say to your soul, be shy from the sight of Allah. For the one who created the darkness that you're in is watching me. He's watching you. It's dark. You're all alone. He's watching you. Ya Abdullah. Where are you going to go? You're going to hide? How you hide from Allah? How you hide from Allah? SubhanAllah. You can't hide from Allah. Allah is watching you. And he sees you. And what did the next verse say? من خشي الرحمن بالغيب. من خشي الرحمن بالغيب. وجاء بقلب منيب. الله أكبر. Comes to his heart. He comes to Allah with a continuously repentant heart. ادخلوها بسلام. That's what we said to you, Abdullah. ادخلوها بسلام. الله أكبر. Enter it بسلام. ذلك يوم الخلود. That is the day which is forever. الله أكبر. Forever, يا عبد الله. إلى أبد الآباد. For أهل التوحيد, أهل السنة. People of great عقيدة. ذلك يوم الخلود. لهم ما يشاءون فيها. They will have everything that they want in it. From the, which is خير, that which is good, that which Allah provides for them. ولدينا مزيد. And we will give them that which is more. We will give them extra. That which is more. They will see Allah يوم القيامة. That is the meaning of that verse. They will see Allah. These verses all mention, clarify, proof. As mentioned in the tafsir as well of those verses, that the believers will see Allah. We don't know how, but we believe in it. As Shariq al-Qadi said to them, tell them, those Mu'tazila, that we take our deen from the sons of the Sahaba, from the Tabi'een. Where do they take their deen from? Allahu Akbar. This is powerful. We take our deen from the sons of the Sahaba, from the Sahaba. Where do they take their deen from? We are far. We don't have any doubts about what we're on. This is deen, akhi. We take it from the sons of Zahab. Where do they take their deen from? Number 11. It's up to 13, this particular aqidah. Number 11. وَأَنَّ لَهُ إِصْبَعًا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has. He says here, إِصْبَعًا بِقَوْلِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ مَا مِنْ قَلْبٍ إِلَّا وَهُوَ بَيْنَ أُصْبُعَيْنِ من أصابع الرحمن. And that word إصبع in the Arabic language is about 10 ways of saying it. Whether it's إصبع, أصبع, إصبع. And there's different ways. Because I remember hearing one of my teachers, Sheikh Abd al-Rahman al-Kuni in Medina from the Ocean of Knowledge in Arabic language. It is about 10 ways of saying it. And I heard also Sheikh Muhammad bin Hadi mentioned it. Sheikh Muhammad bin Hadi mentioned that as well. So even if your Arabic is not that good, usually you'll get it right, inshallah. you'll get one of the 10, inshallah. Anyway, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has that which is described with fingers, like he's mentioned, that the hearts of the servants are between the two fingers of Rahman. He changes it how he wills. He changes it how he wills. The hearts of the servants. قلوب العباد بين أصبعين من أصابع الرحمن يقلبها كيف يشاء. And that is a narration in Muslim Imam Ahmad. And before that is in Sahih Muslim. نعم. And we affirm that which Allah has affirmed for himself. وإن هذه المعاني, number 12, وإن هذه المعاني التي وصف الله بها نفسه وصفه بها رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم مما لا يدرك حقيق ذلك بالفكر والرواية ولا يفكر بالجهل بها أحد إلا بعد انتهاء الخبر إليه بها. So this is not to be taken from anyone's thoughts, anyone's thinking how these attributes are going to be, or even affirming them based upon your thoughts. This is about ittiba'. It's about Allah mentioning it and the messengers also mentioning it and us affirming and also submitting to it. It's not to be derived from any ignorance or any thoughts that people may derive their aqidah from. No, this aqidah is about dalil, about proof. And number 13, فَإِنْ كَانَ الْوَارِدُ بِذَلِكَ خَبَرًا يَقُومُ فِي الْفَهْمِ مَقَامَ الْمَشَاهَدَةِ فِي السَّمَاعِ وَجَبَتْ الدَّيْنُونَ عَلَى سَامِعِهِ بِحَقِيقَتِهِ وَالشَّهَادَةُ عَلَيْهِ كَمَا عَيَنَا وَسَمِعَ مِنْ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صلى الله عليه وسلم. So just as the proof has come to you about these beautiful names and attributes, you must accept them. It's deen. It's a matter of deen. You must accept them. Just as if you have taken it directly from Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. So long as there is an isnad, authentic narration, mentioned that Allah has these beautiful names and attributes, يعني from the Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم, and the hadith is a sahih, whether it's ahad or not ahad, so long as it is narrated, even if it's by few narrators, and even those who say, we only accept those ahadith which are mutawatir, which are narrated by many, they cannot give you what mutawatir means. Because even the scholars differ as what does mutawatir mean. And the scholars, when they categorize ahadith into those narrated by many and those narrated by few, they didn't have an intention to reject those narrated by few. Why would they would do that? When they already established five conditions to accept a hadith sahih. And from those conditions, it doesn't say it has to be narrated by many. From those conditions is that the narrator is trustworthy and precise, and he's upright, he's just, and there is no disconnection in the chain of narration, and it doesn't oppose that which is more authentic, and no, there is no hidden defect. So they already established five conditions of acceptance. The likes of Ibn Hajar, rahimahullah, and other than him, who have already mentioned, Ibn Asakir, and other than him, who wrote 1,000 lines of poetry just about the preservation of this knowledge of Mustalah al-Hadith. For somebody to come later on and start saying, whispering and saying, oh, we don't accept these narrations. These narrations. First and foremost, we have these narrations in the Quran. You still don't accept it. We have these narrations in authentic narrations which are directly coming from those narrations which are in Bukhari and Muslim, Ya Abdullah. The Ummah has accepted Bukhari and Muslim with Qabul. The most authentic books after the Quran, the book Sahih al-Bukhari and Sahih Muslim. Sahih al-Bukhari and Sahih Muslim, the most authentic books after the book of Allah, and the Ummah has accepted it with Qabul, Ijma'. For somebody to come afterwards and start causing shubuhat, doubts, then it's rejected. So here, Imam Shafi said, as if you hear from Rasulullah directly, as if you see in Prophet directly, that he's telling you this. ولكن نثبت هذه الصفات وننفي التشبيه كما نفى ذلك عن نفسه. So we affirm these صفات and we negate any similitude that they make with Allah, just as Allah and His Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم have negated any تشبيه. ليس كمثله شيء. And he mentioned that ليس كمثله شيء وهو السميع البصير. That is the end of that اعتقاد. اعتقاد of Imam Shafi'i رحمه الله in 13 points. And there's another place where he has another 29 points. Maybe one day we can do that as well. But that is just in brief. This is important to know, because anyone comes later, you can explain to him, أخي, don't give me anyone later. Don't tell me Razi says, don't tell me Zamakhshari says, Don't tell me Juwayni says. I'm telling you Imam Shafi rahimahullah says. I'm telling you Imam Ahmad rahimahullah says. I'm telling Imam Malik rahimahullah says. I'm going back early. You want to go classical scholars? Because they said to you, brother, these are classical scholars. Akhi, let's go more classical. Let's go more classical. Because if you're going to bring me someone 7th, 8th century, I'll bring you 7th, 8th century. We'll be here all night. But let's go further than that. Let's go 1st, 2nd, 3rd century. They're the best generation. The Prophet said, خَيْرُ النَّاسِ قَرْنِي ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ يَلُونَهُمْ ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ يَلُونَهُمْ Hadith in Bukhari. And it's mutawatir as well. The best people of my generation, then them to come after them, then them to come after them. So you want to go classical? We go more classical. بارك الله فيك سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. الحمد لله عقيدة أهل السنة is preserved. It's preserved. It doesn't need for anyone. All we have to do is translate. That's all it is. Just translate what the scholars have said. And alhamdulillah. Is it difficult? You know, Ahl al-Sunnah, they're happiest people. It's not difficult. It's easy for us. Alhamdulillah. We go out from wide door. Bab wasi'. Why? Because we just accept. We accept. We don't liken Allah to creation. We don't negate these names and attributes. We accept. That's beautiful. But they have a problem. Because now they reject. As Muhammad Ammar rahimahullah said in Aqid al-Wasitiyah, they first do is reject. No, the first do, what they do first is tashbih. Oh, they liken Allah to creation. Then they have to run away from that tashbih. Then they have to reject it. Then they have to find something else to replace it. They do ta'wil. So they do three things. We just do what Allah told us to do. We don't have to jump from this one to that one to that one. Jazakum Allah khair. Wallahu a'lam. Are there any corrections? Marhaba. Questions? No problem. If we know, you know. If we don't know, Allah a'lam. And no problem, corrections. You made a mistake, I made a mistake. No problem. If we quoted something out of context or out of an error, bring us the proof. And then we'll follow that. Because that's more beloved to us. That's more beloved to us than at-tamadi fil batil. Alhamdulillah. This is how the ulama, this is the tarbiyah of the ulama. Yes. How many times is Sheikh Rabi taking back any error? How many times? Why? Because he doesn't want it to carry on after he dies for that error to continue. But others, they become arrogant to accept it. And when they leave their area, they even take their chair with them because of authority. They want their authority. They want the kursi. You see? They want the kursi. Alhamdulillah. It's clear. لا تزال طائفة من أمتي على الحق ظاهرين لا يضرهم من خذلهم ولا من خالفهم حتى يأتي أمر الله وهم على ذلك. It's clear as daylight. People come into this masjid causing a bit of fitna because they went with this one and that one and did. Alhamdulillah. In the end, it's clear, isn't it? Just cause a bit of commotion and in the end, what happened? You go back to your cave and you still the clarity still goes forward. Alhamdulillah. Da'wah to Salafiyya is still established. Did Sheikh Rabi' fall? Did Sheikh Salih Fawzan fall? Did Sheikh Al-Haydan fall? Did Sheikh Ubaid Hafidah fall? They came together just last week. Sheikh Ubaid and Sheikh Rabi' together, hugging each other. Imam hugging Imam. Allahu Akbar. Sheikh Muhammad bin Hadi doing the Muqaddimah. Another Imam. And Sheikh Abdullah Bukhari Zahal Akhir also. And Sheikh Suleiman Rahili was there. And other scholars were there. With more than 4,000, 5,000 people attending. That's just there. People coming from Riyadh, people coming from Jeddah, people coming from Makkah. Huh? Ulama unknown, ya akhi. Jibal, mountains of knowledge. You just come yesterday and all of a sudden you want to cause a bit of commotion. In the end, you fall. Khalas, it's over, akhi. It's done. Why? Because you get exposed. Because you are isolated. Your da'wah was isolated. You want to be on your own. And you and your followers, you see them. Just look at them. Walking in dark corners. Miserable, dark, you know, through the shadows. Why, akhi? Our da'wah is open. You have something? Bring it. Bring it. You speak ill of ulama, you will fall. You revile the Ahl Sunnah, you will fall. And those who used to come to this masjid reviling the likes of Sheikh Rabi' or following their teacher who reviled Sheikh Rabi'. Sheikh Rabi' Abdul refuted him recently in a book, in two volumes. Refuted this Hajuri in two volumes. And said to him, ulama upon one way and you upon one way. And you've made takhrib of this knowledge that you've just put forward. Takhrib, you have corrupted, you have spoiled this knowledge that you have done, that you have brought forward. and it's a waste, it's worthless, he said, what you have put forward. Allahu Akbar, big words. This is from the Imam of Jarh al-Ta'dil saying this about this individual. Worthless what you have brought. Worthless what you have brought. Imam, Sheikh Rabi Hafidhullah, the likes of Sheikh Albani rahimahullah, what he said about him. The Imam of Hadith in this time, and what he's in Shahida Lahu, that Yarfa Rayat al Jarh al Ta'dil, that he's holding the flag of Jarh al Ta'dil. Sheikh Nu'thaymi rahimahullah, when he was asked about Sayyid Qutb, he said, go to Sheikh Rabi', he will tell you about Sheikh Rabi', about Sayyid Qutb, regarding the errors that he has in his books. Sheikh Ibn Baz rahimahullah writes with his own hands, he didn't reach that level, with his own hands writing, please Sheikh Rabi', tell me about, tell me about this individual on that and this situation, whatever. Asking who? Sheikh Rabi' Hafidhullah. Imam in the times of the Imams. You want to come yesterday and all of a sudden and try to demolish a mountain? Ya natih al jabali likay tuhdimahu ishfiq ala rasik wa la tishfiq ala al jabali. Oh, one who wants to headbutt the mountain, have mercy on your head. Don't have mercy on the mountain. The mountain's firm. Wasting your time, you're going to try to headbutt the mountain. You're wasting your time. And the end result is what? The end result, you fall. And your followers fall in murky waters. You fall in the shadows, in the dark corners, you fall. Huh? But the ulama, they stay up, upright. And then the same individual, he want now to refute Sheikh Rabi' with a weak reputation, which he has in their website called Samum, supposedly Ulum. And they're writing, and he's writing, and he said about Sheikh Rabi', still continuing. And he said about the Sheikh Rabi' Hafidhullah, what can come from bitter, what can come from a bitter mouth except bitterness? That's what he says about Sheikh Rabi'. What can come from a bitter mouth except bitterness? You're still carrying on. You will fall more then. The higher you try to go, the higher, you, the more you will fall. How you speak against Ahlul Ilm, ya akhi? Have no shame. إِذَا لَمْ تَسْتَحِ فَاصْنَعْ مَا شِئْتَ. If you have no shame, do as you wish. Speaking about the Imams like this, with this vile speech. We never saw that in our time when Sheikh Rabi' Hafidhullah and other scholars, when they would address Sheikh Ibn Baz rahimahullah and Sheikh Nu'thaymi rahimahullah and Sheikh Salih Fawzi, they would never address them with this vile speech. Check yourself. Go back to the drawing board. Go back and see how the Salaf used to be and how they would respect the ulama who came before them. Reviving and loving and honoring and respecting Ahlul Ilm and respecting the Sahaba before even that. And respecting the Prophet, I'm not saying that he made mistakes in the means of da'wah. Speaking about Sahaba, a whole page about Sahaba's mistakes. Then he takes it, new print comes out, nothing is said. Oh, all quiet. No, you make a big mountain out of other people's mistakes. You also need to also make a mountain about your mistakes. And say and take back what you said about the Sahaba. We're still waiting. We're still waiting. So wake up. Those who don't know, wake up. Read Arafat's book. Sheikh Rabi', Sheikh Ubayd Hafidhullah's muqaddimah of it and his introduction to it, and it's been praised by the ulama. Read it. Don't be shy. Read it. The proof is there. And that which has come from your so-called 1,000 students against Sheikh Rabi' and others, where are they now? Alhamdulillah, many of them left. Many of them left. Our brother Hani bin Barak, jazallah khair, who's in Yemen. MashaAllah, he said many of them left and they came to us and they made tawbah. And you know what they said? They said, Alhamdulillah, because Hajuri, he deceived us. Or he, what's the word? Khadalana, he abandoned us. When it's time now to be a man and defend your land, he goes to Makkah, leaves the people to defend themselves. When it's time to be a man, Alhamdulillah, those who stayed behind, they stayed behind and they defended. Alhamdulillah, they managed to defend the Aden. Now it's Ahlul Sunnah, it's not with the Shia. Alhamdulillah, ni'mah. Isn't that ni'mah? Ni'mah! Ahlul Sunnah. They defend. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. It's not just about speech, is it? It's not just about memorizing. It's about deen. Defending the ranks. Loving Ahlul Sunnah. And defending that. Walillah alhamd. Jazakum Allah. to advise them if they have knowledge. To advise them or leave them. Don't waste your time. There's many people want the khair out there. Many people are crying out for tawheed. Many people crying out for sunnah. To advise them. Khalas, it's over. Let's move on. Over. Take back what was said. If you spoke against any of these calls, go and see them, go and visit them. You see their whole life is upon ibadah and their whole life is upon defending the deen. Time and time again, 60, 70 years defending da'wah to salafiyya. You come lately and thinking that you can run the whole show. It's not on your shoulders, akhi. When did you just come? It's not about when did you just come. It's not on your shoulders. That's it, full stop. It's not on your shoulders. Ulama are known. The ulama, the Rabbaniyun, they are known. Sheikh Al-Haydan, Hafidhullah, he said, Sheikh Rabi rose in our eyes. He rose. His position rose. You know why? Because now at that time, King Abdullah, he called them to gather. And there were other people gathering together in that majlis. You had political activists. And you had... Sheikh Rabi spoke. Spoke against the Rafida. Not to give them, you know, their position and so on. That this country, Saudi, should remain upon Sunnah and so on. And Sheikh Al-Haydan said, in our eyes, Sheikh Rabi rose in our eyes in that majlis. Why? Because he sufficed us. We didn't have to speak because he spoke. And he defended the ranks of Ahl al-Sunnah. He rose. Amidst who? Amidst the best of the people. You come lately and you want to speak against the best of the people like that and you're going to succeed. Wallahi, you will fall and you will continue to fall. And you better make tawbah before you die for what you have done, for the misguidance you caused and the confusion you caused in the ummah. Make tawbah. And the rest of them, let them make tawbah and come back to the truth. Come back to haqq. This is deen. This is firmness. This is istiqamah. This is ithabat. It's not joking. It's not playing. This is sunnah. This is dalil. You bring proof, ahlan wa sahlan. Follow it. This is how the scholars have trained us. Follow the proof. تَبِعُوا مَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكُمْ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا مِنْ دُونِ أَوْلِيَاءَ. Follow that which has been revealed to you from your Lord. Do not follow others besides that, in opposition to that. About deen. And many of them now, is mashallah, look how many of them become fizzled, weakened, gone wherever they go. It's long road, akhi. Not short road. It's not a few months. It's not a club. It's not come yesterday and then all of a sudden cause a bit of commotion, cause a confusion, and then go off again. You're accountable for what you do. You're accountable for what you say. It's about deen. And we don't really bother. I haven't even seen how many years I haven't even seen. Just once, I just saw his refutation recently, this weak one. But we don't bother with him anymore. Why? Because it's over. It's done. Buried. It's clear for the ones, even for the many who are. So tell them, advise them if they have knowledge. If they don't have knowledge, move on. Why you want to waste time? Don't mix with them. Don't mix with them because you're not upon confusion. They are upon confusion. And if they are upon confusion and they're not sincere, then let them go to someone who's confused like them. We have to move on. Tariq is part, it's clear for us to keep going. Keep going and stick and remain with Ahl al-Ilm. And love them. If you can't be a student, love the people of knowledge. Can't be a student, love them at least. And anyone who speaks ill of them, reviles them, ma'as salama. Don't need you. Because Abu Zur al-Razi, Abu Hatim al-Razi, from the great scholars of Ahl al-Sunnah in the 4th century, they said, Alamatu Ahl al-Bid'ah, Al-Waqi'atu fi Ahl al-Athar. Have we forgot the narrations? Why are we reading these books of the Salaf? The signs of the innovators, they speak ill of the people of narrations. And if Sheikh Rabi' and Sheikh Ubaid and Sheikh Abad, they're not people of narrations, who is then? You sleep in. Doesn't mean you accept everything they say, even mistake. No, if it's a mistake, we don't take it from them. But respect. So some honor, yaqi. Have some shame. Barakallahu feekum. Barakallahu feekum. Many, many lies were spread. Confusions, lies, deception, cut and paste. And they will be accountable in front of Allah. One by one. We already dealt with one of them until he made tawbah. Yes. And then when he made tawbah, he took it down again. You see? Games. And we said to him, you want to continue? We're ready. وَإِنْ عُدْتُمْ عُدْنَا. You come back, we'll come back. We ain't afraid. This is a long road, Yahi. Who cares? You bring me my mistake. Alhamdulillah, Jazakallah khair. You mentioned a mistake. Astaghfirullah, tubu ilayk if it's true. Alhamdulillah, shukran. Jazakallah khair. But we're going to go together. You want to go? Let's go all the way. And that's how Ahlul Ilm are. Sheikh Rabi says, yes. I'm happy you tell me my mistakes. Jazakallah khair. That I won't die upon that error. You see? It's a long road. But we go down together. Let's see who is sincere and who's not sincere. And in the end, what happened? He made Tawbah. Oh, we occupied the people. No, you occupied the people. Because you brought lies. You occupied the people. Busying the people with lies and deception. You're going to be accountable. Yawm al-Qiyam, I'm still waiting for you, inshallah. I haven't forgotten. Barakallahu feek. Hayyakum Allah. General ruling and specific ruling. General ruling, that whoever commits shirk is a mushrik. Specific ruling, they don't call person a kafir specifically until they establish the proof on him. That's ijma on that. But now the question is, where the difference, slight difference is amongst the scholars is it enough to tell them, for them to hear the proof? Is that considered to be establishment of the proof? Or do they have to understand it? That's where the slight difference is amongst the scholars. That's another issue. And even that, there's a lot of kalam regarding that. But now, when we're not going to enter it, suffice to us to say what the scholars of Ijma, they mentioned. Clearly, that is, don't call a Muslim a kafir until you establish the proof on him. That's Ijma on that. That's mentioned by Ibn Abd al-Barr, and Ibn Qudama, and Ibn Taymiyyah, Ibn al-Qayyim. And there's a brother, mashallah, tabarakallah, who's got a whole book on it. He compiled this whole book. Mashallah, Sheikh Rabi did the muqaddimah of that book. And that book is a good book. And in there is got also the A'immat al-Da'wah, Muhammad Wahhab, rahimahullah, and his students. And they all mention about this. Leave the other issue of faham al-hujjah, or is it enough to have the hujjah to have reached them. That's another issue. But the stick to the basic issue, the fundamental issue. That is, don't call a Muslim a disbeliever specifically unless you establish the proof on them. And the Prophet warned us, من قال لأخيه يا كافر فقد باء به أحدهما. Whoever says to his brother, oh disbeliever, it falls on one of the two. Because your honor, إن دماءكم وأموالكم وأعراضكم حرام عليكم كحرمة هذا اليوم كحرمة هذا البلد. Don't go around calling Muslim kufar. Be careful. It's a serious matter. Ahlul Sunnah considered to be serious. That's why Imam Ahmad rahimullah, he lived through four rulers. Three of them, they said the Quran is created. And none of them he called kuffar. Even though one who believes that the Quran is created is a disbeliever. But the application of it from Imam Ahmad rahimullah is the ijma'. And that is, he didn't call them specifically a kafir because the proof was not established upon them. This is clear as daylight. Clear as daylight. And this is how we use to refute the takfiris with. This detail that I'm telling you about, this is from who? It's from Sheikh Ubayn, Habidullah, Sheikh Rabi, Habidullah, Sheikh Salih Fawzan, Habidullah, and others. In terms of not calling a Muslim a kafir until you establish the proof. Sheikh Nu'taymin, rahimahullah, told me directly, and it's in his book, Wa'id al-Mutla, and Sheikh bin Baz, rahimahullah, in his statements, Ijma' ya akhi, this century, and Sheikh Albani rahimahullah. Don't go around rushing to call Muslim a kafir. And with all of this, and with the proof, and with the fahm of salaf, the statements and narrations of the salaf, we have hujjah. We have proof. We have ijma'. So takfiri, when he comes, he can't even, he can't waste our time. That's why when I met one takfiri, and he was trying to cause a bit of confusion, I said to him, Imam Ahmad Usul Sunnah. He said, what is that? They don't even know the books of Ahlul Sunnah. You want now, how am I going to discuss now Y, Z? You don't know A, B, you know? So, takfiris, they don't have knowledge. They are weak. Barakallahu feekum. It's got to be, you have to be ready. Barakallahu feekum. لا إله إلا أنت استغفرك إليك. جزاكم الله خيرا إخوان. الله يحفظكم بارك فيكم. الله protect us all. Especially in this time of many doubts. نستكمل أهل العلم يكون خير البركة.